Hello my friends and welcome again to my video channel. Today we are talking about a small high voltage generator for testing capacitors, semiconductors, cables, wirings and so on. There is a possibility to create high voltages in the range of 1 or 2 kV with a transformer, voltage multiplier, cascades and so on, but all these units driven by 50 Hz are rather big, expensive, cost some money, take a lot of space and so on. So it was not my solution. I looked for a better solution, simply very cheap and effective, and I found this. It's a so-called inverter for cold cathode lamps. This unit is for two lamps, doesn't matter. What does it do? Hope you can read it later, we will see the data sheet in detail. Output voltage or input voltage is 12 volt DC. Okay, output voltage, starting voltage 600 volt AC, frequency 32 kilohertz. This starting voltage 600 volt AC is under load. Under low load or no load condition, it is much higher than 1 kV AC. Peak to peak, which we will have when we make a rectifier, is much higher. This unit is available on the market for, let me say, some euros, 2, 3, 5 euros, dollars, and are available anywhere in the famous base and so on. So I bought some of these things and decided to take a test how it works. After opening the package, I found this small case here, opened it, a self-adhesive strip. Okay, we don't need it in the moment. And inside the data sheet again, a little bit more precise. When we open it, we can read the data in detail. We'll look for the English page here now. It is here inverter for cold cathode lamps. Here are the data. I'm not sure whether you can really read them in detail. Okay, it's not so good, but the same data again. We have here the smaller version, 12 volt DC. It's 12 volt DC, that's it. Maximum 400 milliamps, up to 600 volt AC output at 32 kilohertz. These are the data of this unit. Let's have a look into the electronic. It's a rather small circuit here. What we see here is a transformer, two transistors, some filter caps and so on, inductors, and two capacitors. This seems to be the output, not more. It looks easy, and really it is easy. Unfortunately, there was no circuit diagram in this package here available. As usual, there are no circuit diagrams, but by re-engineering and searching a little bit in the net, I found some hints and some drawings. The rest is re-engineering, it's not so complicated here. When we turn it on the other side, I will show you the schematic at once. We see here some small wirings and so on, output coupling here of the two capacitors. The circuit diagram I have drawn on the paper, and I will show it now. That here is a circuit diagram I have redrawn. The most important parts are here. Input, fuse, 12 volt DC, some filter caps, coils. The most important thing is here, two transistors, NPN, in a typical push-pull configuration. We have here the winding, center tap, plus 12 volt DC are connected here. These transistors are connected with the emitter to the negative supply here, and the feedback is here via this coil here, this tap here. Bias setting here, the transistors are a little bit overdriven, but it's a advantage for us, we will see later. The operation is simple and known. Only one of these transistors is conductive, For example, if we have here plus, if we have here minus, then this transistor is a little bit more positive in the base, then the other gets conductive and the voltage here breaks down. That means on the other side the voltage goes up. Next half wave, here is minus, plus, this minus here means this transistor is blocked, this gets conductive, so the voltage here breaks down and the voltage here goes up. One of the factors which have to be considered is that in a push-pull configuration, the voltage here at the end are double the supply voltage. If we have here 12 volt DC, and for example this transistor conducts to minus, this voltage goes down, then we have a 12 volt, then we have here 24 volt peak. If this transistor gets conductive to ground, the voltage here breaks down, then we have here 0, 12 volt, we have here 24 volt peak. So we have here an effective voltage of 24 volt peak with a 12 volt supply. It's very important to know these transistors have to be designed accordingly. Here is the output with a very high ratio. There are two capacitors here for connecting the cold cathode fluorescent lamps. We don't need it, so we can delete it. The interesting point for us is here and here. There we have here a very, very high AC voltage. Of course, you see this circuit here is not very stable. The frequency is mainly determined by this circuit here. 47 nanofarad gives this specified anything kilohertz. What we have, what did they say? 32 kilohertz approximately, we will measure it. However, the output voltage is not stabilized. That means if there's a load, the voltage goes down. This nominal load is some milliamps here, only milliamps, but 1 milliamp at 1 kV is also 1 watt. So it's not so so small as it sounds. As it looks like, it's a very, very high voltage. Okay, we have to measure it. First to remove these two capacitors and connect our metering here. So we have to remove these two capacitors here and the connectors and connect our probe directly, 2 kV probe directly here to measure the output voltage. We will expect 2 kV peak or 4 kV peak. That will be the maximum voltage which we get out here approximately. This has been done here. A bit more focus. Oops, sorry, wrong direction. The capacitors are removed, connectors also, and these two blue wires here are connected directly to the output winding, to the high voltage winding of the transformer. So we can measure directly here with a multimeter or a scope the output voltage. And now to the test setup. The inverter is connected here to a DC power supply via the cable. The plug is in here. It's regulated from 0 to 20 or 30 volt. In parallel, we have here a digital multimeter. The output here, we talked about, connected directly to the transformer here, is connected via a special high voltage probe to the scope input. It's very, very important to use probes here which are suited for this high voltage. Standard probes are limited to, let me say, 500 or 600 volt DC plus AC. So it's a very sure way to kill your scope or your probe when you use this inverter with a standard probe. This here is specified up to 2500 volts at a ratio of 100 to 1. 100 to 1 means 10 volt division here means exactly 1000 volt. It is 1000, 2000, 3000 volt. This scope is calibrated forever in kilovolts. Next step is to increase the voltage a little bit, but I will make a little bit zoom on the scope and on the display here so that you see the direct relation between supply voltage and the output. Okay, let's increase the supply voltage. The unit is specified for 12 volt DC, but we will see it operates also with very low voltages. It's the advantage of the overfeedback we have seen in the circuit diagram the transistors are a little bit overdriven, but that is an advantage. So the unit operates also starting from approximately 3 volt. You see here the DC supply voltage and here the output voltage. Remember, this is 1 kV, 2 kV, 3 kV. From peak to peak, it's 8 kV. We have a DC supply of 2.3 volt and an output of 1 kV peak or 500 volt peak. We can increase up to 6 volt, so we have 1 kV here peak or 2 kV peak. At 12.4, a little bit more than what is specified, doesn't matter. So we have an output voltage of nearly 2 kV peak or 4 kV peak. 4 kV peak is a lot. It's a lot of power, a lot of voltage, but that's what we want. And we see we have a relatively stable output, but it is not loaded. No output. We will see what happens when we load it, but in the moment we are talking about non-loaded. The unit is 10 microseconds per division, so we can count 10, 20, so I would say the frequency is approximately 50 kilohertz. Oh, how goes it with the cursors? Cursors on, ah, that's nice. Let's move this cursor here. Let's switch to the other cursor. Let's go to this here. From sine wave to sine wave, yes. So we have a time difference of up for approximately 20 microseconds. It's 50 kilohertz. Yes, 48 kilohertz frequency. Specified is 32. Okay, doesn't matter. The higher the frequency, the better for us. Interesting here is that we can control the output voltage with the supply voltage. When we go back, we can go down, 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 and it is stable again. I increase it. Now we have 200 volt per division. So we have 400 volt peak at 1.3 volt supply. And it is there is no hysteresis in it. If I go up voltage here, and in this moment at 1.3, it operates again. So we have a very wide range for tuning the output voltage, for setting it, and it is very effective for us. Okay, in the moment we have an AC output, but in general we want, or for most purposes, we want a DC output. So we need a rectifier. After we removed these two capacitors here, we can install four diodes as a bridge rectifier configuration with a filtering cap. We need here, of course, high voltage diodes, for example, type HV6 from Diotech. A short calculation, if we get an output voltage of 2 kV DC, we need a reverse voltage of about minimum 4 kV for these diodes. A little bit reserve, I think 5 or 6 kV is a good choice, so I decided to use this diode here, HV6, because the price difference between HV5 and HV6 is nearly zero. These diodes are rather cheap. One thing is important, whatever you choose, you have to consider the operating frequency here is around 50 kilohertz. And one important feature of such diodes is recovery time. You can see it, yes, it's okay. These diodes, HV5, have a recovery time of 400 nanoseconds. That's 0.4 microseconds. Sounds okay, but when we consider operating voltage of 50 kilohertz is a period of 20 microseconds, so these 0.4 microseconds are a little bit, okay, we can operate with it, but you have to be careful when choosing diodes. This recovery time is rather important. Okay, this is the solution. we have to remove the C's here, capacitors and the plugs here, so we have here a free space. And this is a practical solution. We have the four diodes here, using the holes of the two capacitors, and the two holes are from the plugs, which have been removed, and this is the filter cap. We do not need to drill additional holes here. We have enough holes to install here this bridge rectifier. On the bottom side, it looks like this. We have here the two output connectors, plus and minus. Plus is where the two cathodes are. So this here is plus. The upper side is plus and the lower side is minus. We will see when we measure it. That's all we need. And now we have a signal generator DC up to 2 kV adjustable. And now again our test configuration. The generator is connected to the power supply. HV probe here. Scope is again set to 10 volts per division. That means 1 kilovolt per division, because we have here a factor of 100 to 1. And here we measure the supply voltage. Increasing the input voltage, the supply voltage makes more output voltage. And at 12.1 kV, we have more than 2 kV voltage, output voltage, DC. But let's look a little bit more detailed on it. Again, same configuration. I'll make off the light. I think it's a little bit better. Okay. Zero. At zero DC supply voltage, increasing the supply voltage, 5 volt, so we have 1 kV output. At 11.2 we have 2 kV output, and at 12 we have 2.2 kV output voltage. Again, 10 volt times 100 is 1 kV per division. The scope has no graphical illumination, unfortunately. Maybe it's a little bit better here. Okay, so you see the graphical lines, maybe a little bit better here. 1 kV, 2 kV, and we are above it. We can go a little bit higher, 2.0 kV at 13 volt DC supply. I think there is a limit. You shouldn't override it, otherwise there is a danger of destroying anything. And this is our output voltage of 2.3 kV. Can be adjusted. Even with very low input or supply voltage, as we have seen with the AC the signature, we see it also on the DC. We have a 2 volt input, we have an output voltage of 400 volts or something like this. Well, that's the generator itself. In this moment we could say, okay, we have a high voltage generator, but I'm always a friend of having a case and a little bit better connection to it, not so such a provision like here. So I decided to use a case and make a little bit better construction. And also the voltage supply here is not the optimum. This is power supply here. I prefer a better voltage regulation for it, to have a better feeling when operating with it. For better handling and a good voltage regulation of the supply voltage, I designed a small circuit here. It is a very usual circuit. We have here a transistor, Q1 in series. It's a series voltage regulator. Input is 18 to 20 volt DC constant. These volts here are set down, maximum 400 milliampere, the protection against wrong connection. This Q1 and Q2 is a Darlington configuration, and the voltage can be set with this potentiometer here. Between maximum voltage is 15 volt here and nearly to zero, down to zero. By our R3, this voltage is fed to the base, and so we have a regulated output voltage between zero and approximately 13 volt. We have a 15 volt and some voltage loss here and here over the base emitter, so output is approximately not more than 13 volt. This circuit here is a current limitation. The minus of the inverter here is fed over this resistor R6 to ground. This is 1.5 ohms. That means a current beyond 400 milliamps, which is a specified maximum current of the inverter. 400 milliamps makes 600 millivolt voltage drop here, and this makes this Q3 conductive, and this reduces here the base voltage, so the current is limited to approximately 400 milliamps output. It's luxury, it's not necessary. If you have a voltage supply which can be set to 400 milliamps, then you don't need this here. But it's always difficult to set an exact limit, so it's good to have a small circuit here. Why not? But as I told you, you don't completely not need this circuit here. You can use your power supply and connect the inverter directly to it. But I decided to make this little circuit here. It's a little bit funny, it makes joke, but okay, do it or do it not. And this here is the mechanical and electrical result. Here we have the inverter. I have chosen a different diodes. It's BY509 or something like this. This is also another high voltage diode, but it's not relevant. Filter cap, output connection. Here's a small circuit for the voltage regulation. That's a pot here, and that's the input here with the protection diode, filter cap, and so on. This fits into a little cover here, into this little case here, and can be easily constructed. This is a voltage regulator transistor here, set directly on the case with a glimmer between for isolation. This can get sometimes a little bit hot if there's a high current flowing, so we have some voltage drop over this transistor and some 100 milliamp, so it can make 1, 2, or 3 watts power dissipation, a little bit hot. On the other side, it looks like this here. So good. Ah, okay, that's better here now. I've chosen a big knob here, so it's easier to adjust the voltage here. A small scale, it's calibrated for this purpose. A label on it, you know, it's dangerous voltage here, 2 kV, if there's a capacitor connected with a high capacity, so you get a nasty bite or even a lethal shock, so be careful here. Here is the input supply here. Oh, sorry, a little bit dark. It's a standard jack here. You can use whatever you want. Okay, that's it. You see a small case. I will close it and show us the result. A simple final test to show the load behavior of this H voltage generator. HV generator here. As we have seen, we can generate voltages up to 2000 volt and a little bit more. I have here added some resistors as a load. Each of these resistors has 100 kilo ohm. 5 resistors in series, it's 500 kilo ohms. I've chosen it because transistors have not a so high voltage over their leads. They do not accept 1 kV, so you have to be careful when adding resistors. So we have here at 1 kV maximum 200 volt per resistor. That's okay. We can increase the output voltage. You see here 280. Oh, it's okay. You can see it here. 500. Yes, you see it here. The scale is not valid any longer because we have a load here. But we come to a voltage of more than overload. Okay. This instrument here specified 1000 volt DC. Category 2, 1000 volt DC, so we have to be careful. We have now 1 kV output at a load of 500 kilo ohms. That's 2 milliamps. 1 kilovolt, 500 kilo ohm, that's 2 milliamp load. 1 kilovolt, 2 milliamp load is 2 watt. And these resistors are dissipated in the moment 2 watts. It's not too much because the resistors are of load, heavy load resistors. But to show you which output power here is, it's a small generator, but it's generating 2 watts. It's, I think, a lot of it for this small generator. If you would reduce the load or disconnected, the voltage would suddenly jump up to more than 1500 volts. So if you have suddenly a no load condition, the voltage here jumps up. It is not stabilized, as I said. It's a free running generator, no stabilization. You have to be careful. So we take it down, disconnect the power supply, and then we can look what we have. Okay, in my next video sequence, I will show you some tests with capacitors and other equipment, semiconductors and so on, what we can do with this. Well, my friends, before we start testing something, we should first think a little bit about measuring technique. We all have voltmeters which high impedance of approximately 10 megohm or so. But please consider 10 megohm is a maximum input also for very high voltage ranges. If you measure in some 100 volts or kV range, the input is 10 megohm. If we have a configuration generator here, ampere meter, voltmeter and device under test, then we have here current flowing through the voltmeter. 1 kV, 10 megohm is 100 microamps. There will flow 0.1 milliamp through the voltmeter. We have it here, voltmeter. We go up to 1 kV, we show it. And we see the current in microamps indicated here. When I go up to first 500 volts, we see here 51 microamps flowing into it. Let's go up to 1 kV. I have to be careful not to override it. Overload. We exactly measure 1 kV here. And the input current is 100 microamps. Of course, you can say when I have a device under test here, I can subtract this current, because I know 100 microamps are flowing in there. But it's not necessary. This configuration is simply wrong. Don't use it. The better one is this here. First, measure the voltage, then the current. You have here a voltage drop of some 100 millivolts or so. Doesn't matter at 1 kV, because the ammeter are all very low ohmic. So it's the best configuration to have a voltmeter here directly connected, and the ampere meter only measures the current flowing through the dot here. No other current, so you don't have to think about it. But first, some small mathematics to evaluate what we can expect when we are charging or discharging capacitors. Voltage is given as charge by capacity, or change of voltage is given by the rate of change of charge related to capacity. Or it is current, we assume the current is constant, times delta time by delta time, times 1 per capacity. This here, dq is this here, dt is this, and on 1 by C is this here. So we can write it, because this and this shorts out here, so we can write current related to capacity is a change of rate. If we use some units, for example, we have 1 milliamp as charging current, and we have a capacity of 100 microfarad, we use a little bit mathematics, you can study it and try, maybe you'll find an error. I'm quite sure there's no error, but if you find one, you can tell me. 1 milliamp at 100 microfarad means 10 volt per second. 10 volt per second is the rate of change of the voltage when we charge it with 1 milliamp. It rises, of course, when we discharge it, it falls with 10 volt per second. This is the rate here. 100 microfarad capacity, only to have a rule of thumb to say, okay, that's a relation we can expect. Let's make some tests. We have here a small capacitor, 0.5 microfarad, 630 volt DC, connected to the voltmeter and to the ammeter as shown. First voltmeter, and then from the voltmeter the current goes through this ammeter into the capacitor. I increase it 300, 400 with increasing voltage, the charging current decreases. We are coming to a stable point following an exponential curve here. But at a certain point, you will see that the current doesn't decrease and the voltage doesn't increase. That means this current here goes completely into the loss, into the ohmic loss of the capacitor, not into the charge. We are at 402 volt, 1.4 microamps. Let's go to 500 volts. Oh, a bit too high, sorry. Nine stable, 2.1 microamps, okay, 3 microamp, not increasing voltage any longer. It is not linear, as you see. And we have 630 volt maximum. I go try to go to 630 volt. Careful, careful, not to kill it. Well, at 4 microamps, 623, 4 microamps. So you see the current is increasing a little bit more than the voltage, because 2 microamps should be at 310 volts. Okay. We have 312, but not 2 microamp. We have only 0.8 microamp at half voltage, much less than half the current. This is a nonlinear relationship. Okay, we could discuss whether it's okay or not. It depends upon the data sheet. I don't have the data sheet of this capacitor here. You see, the capacitor is slowly discharging. The current is negative here because the capacitor charges over the voltmeter to ground, so we have a negative current here. You have to wait until it is discharged, or use something like this, a resistor and a clamp, to discharge it. Well, I have another capacitor. It's you see, it's a little bit broken here. I don't know whether you can see it exactly here. There's a crack a little bit. We will see what happens. This capacitor should have a withstand voltage of 1000 volt. 1000 volt at 0.1 microfarad, 1000 volt. It's a miracle if it has it. Okay, let's increase it with an increased voltage. volts, 260, 400 volts, we have 400 macrams. Yo, 500 volts, we have 678 microamps. I'm quite sure that this capacitor is not okay. But you see, it's a very extremely non-linear relationship between voltage and current. I have no chance to come up to 1000 volt here, because we have 2 point anything milliamps. I go to milliamp here. No chance to come up. Okay. We can definitely say this capacitor is not okay. It looks bad, and it is bad. joint with the next capacitor. First capacitor, it's a Vima 2000 volt at 68 nanofarads. 2000 volt, yeah, it's okay. Let's go to microamp back here. We'll see what happens. Oh yes, overload. So I kind of measure it with this voltmeter here. I would have to choose another voltmeter because I can't go over 1000 volt with this one. But you can believe me, I've checked it with another voltmeter, went up to 2000 volt, and it is okay. Even at exactly 1000 volt, the current is nearly zero. So this capacitor is surely okay. And the discharge is relative. Okay, 68 nanofarad is not so much. It can be discharged via this voltmeter relatively quickly. Well, that were some standard capacitors. Seem to be okay, one is not okay. Then we can go to some electrolytic caps. Our next device on the test is an electrolytic capacitor, 220 microfarads, 385 volts. 385 volts, 20 microfarad, connected again with voltmeter and ammeter. Increase the voltage. You can do, if you want to charge it up a little bit faster, increase the driving voltage here. But then you have to be careful that you don't overshoot over 385 volts. Otherwise you will have a bang or something like this. Maybe you can protect yourself with a cap over it, plastic cap. I do it here in this case, because I'm not so sure whether it's okay. 385 volts. I have to be careful now. Go down a little bit. Okay. And we come to the 385 volts. Voltage seems to be stable, we don't go exactly up, and have 94 microamps constant. Voltage is a little bit increasing again. So it's drifting around this point here. So this current here is nearly completely going, it's charging up a little bit again. Okay, now it's discharging a bit. So you see we have about 40 microamps current flowing. I think it's okay for a capacitor like this. We see also when you drastically reduce the driving voltage, it discharges the capacitor with negative current over the voltmeter here, but the voltage drops down very, very slowly. So it seems that this capacitor here is okay. I would use it in a circuit, as long as I don't know that it's not in the specification. Now we have to discharge it. It's on the provision. Don't use it for a longer time. It's 22 kilo ohms here to limit the current. You see the voltage drops down drastically. Now it is, if you don't do it and you lay it back into the box charged, it's not so good. If you grab into the box, you could get a nasty bite. And the resistor got a little bit warm. Okay. And now you see it charges up again a little bit, but it doesn't matter. We have here another capacitor. I don't know how old it is. Whether it looks good, 220 microfarad, 350 volt. I have problems to charge it up. It is set to 500 volts nearly. The generator here, but the voltage doesn't increase very rapidly and the current is very high. So, we can wait a moment. But as it looks, you see 2 milliamps and the voltage isn't increasing considerably. It's nearly constant here. It should have 350 volts. And we're stuck here at 113. With this charging current, we should be much faster. So I would say if this capacitor is not okay. No, definitely no, because it's, as you remember, the other capacitor who has 220 microfarad, he also has 220 microfarad, but the other capacitor charged up much faster and here is nearly no progress in voltage, no increase despite of 2 milliamps. And I'm quite sure when we reduce the driving voltage here to zero, it discharges rapidly here. Okay. So I think this capacity is not okay. Let's try it again. I increase the driving voltage to 750 volt according to scale here. My goodness. The battery saver here. No. Well, we have another capacitor, 22 microfarad, 350 volt. So we will see what happens. Try to go up to 350. It charges up very rapidly. It looks rather good. The current is acceptable low. But important is the charging current is falling here. It's decreasing. Voltage is again a little bit increasing. 350 would be the limit. We have to be careful not to override it because the generator is set to approximately 500 volt here. But I think this capacitor here is can be specified as okay. Voltage is still a little bit increasing here. But important for current here is decreasing. Okay, it's not necessary to wait here many hours. I think it can be said it's okay. And the charge, the voltage is rather stable. Discharging over the voltmeter here. Remember it has 10 mega ohms. So you always see the same figure as here. The factor is 10 mega ohm. This voltage here divided by 10 is microamps. Volt, 10 mega ohm, is this here microamps, 288 is 28. So this capacitor is discharged, but it still has 280 volts. So we have to discharge it. It's only a small experiment here. You should make a better one. I will try to construct a better one here. And now we are at nearly zero. And if I want to make it absolutely sure, you can wait here for some minutes. Well, capacitors. The end of capacitors. Now let's go to the semiconductors. The first semiconductor is one of the standard diodes, 1N4148 here. You can see it. Cathode is connected to plus. Anode is connected to minus. The reverse voltage according data sheet is about 75 volts, 100 volts effective, something like this. Look carefully, yes, 75 volt. So we increase the voltage here. Oops. It's a little bit more than the specified 75 because this generator here is not so good for very low voltages, but we have a 127 volt and still only 4 microamps. When we reduce the voltage a little bit here, so we see the current also decreases. The diode is not destroyed here because the current is limited. As long as the current is not so high, the diode cannot be destroyed. And the breakdown is a reverse process as long as the diode is not overloaded. Again, I come down up from 44, 51 volt, 56. Now you see 120 volt starts to increase the current. Okay, we will stop here and can say this diode is okay. 100 volt can be isolated. The next device on the test is a standard diode 1N4007, a very cheap diode, but it has a specified breakdown, reverse breakdown voltage of more than 1000 volt. For this purpose, I need a special voltage divider here. It's a high voltage probe. Factor is 1000. Not 100, it's 1000. Connected here to this voltmeter. So 1 volt here is 1000 volt here. It's a little bit a beast, but it's not possible to measure it in the other way, because this voltmeter here is limited to 1000 volt, to 1 kV, but we need to measure at least 2 kV. The ground of this probe here is connected to the anode here, to the minus pole here, where the anode is connected, and the plus pole here is connected to the input side of the ammeter here, where it comes from the generator. So the current here is showing only the current through the diode here, through this yellow lead here, and not more. It's only the current which goes through the diode here. The current through the probe here is not measured because it's on the input side here. Okay, and now let's start. It's 330 volt. We are at 500 volts, 750. We have a voltage of 1000 volt. No current, not a single microamp flowing. This diode is rather good. And in the range of 1400 volt, current starts to flow. 1.3, nothing. 1.4, 1.5, 1.6, 1.7. Okay, at 1.7, at 1700 volt. Okay, 11 microamps, 22 and so on. 39, the voltage doesn't increase very much, but the current is increasing. So I go down here, because consider only some microamps with 1000 volts is milliwatt. So you shouldn't overdrive and overheat the diode here with this test. But we have seen a 1N4007 is good for a voltage of at least 1000, 1200, yes, 1000 volt, a little bit more than 1000 volt, you can use it as a diode. It's also good for this cheap thing here. Another device or diode under test, LUT diode under test, you can say, is a Z diode with 160 volt, ZD160. I don't know whether you can read it, but it's okay, it is ZD160. That means at 160 volt, it should start into conduct. We can go up to 160 volt. We have here 78. It's again factor 1000. I didn't remove it here, but you can see it's 77 volt here. 123 volt. 100. 150. You see this microamps get starting at the voltage of 150 volt. Okay, we have 3 milliamps here. 3 milliamps at 155 volt. Okay. 4 milliamps at still 156. I don't know the nominal data, but it looks plausible to say it is a ZD 160, 160 volt. It draws current starting with 150 volts. That's what we wanted to see. That's it for now. That's what I wanted to show you, what you can do with this little nice device here. A simple, easy to build, quick and dirty high voltage generator for testing. It's a typical weekender project. If you have the components in one of your boxes, and I'm sure you have it, build it, test it, but please be careful. Charged capacitors beyond 100 volt DC can be lethal. Not only a nasty bite or a shock, it can be lethal, and it's not worth our hobby to be killed. So keep, be careful, but then you can use it and have fun with it.